Good afternoon, I'm Denise Densai, and here are the stories that made it to ANC's rundown. The death toll due to Typhoon Karding rises to 10. Millions in Florida urge to evacuate as Hurricane Ian threatens the state. And the Philippine peso touches the 59 level against the U.S. dollar. The local stock market also falling deeper into bear market territory. Welcome to the program. The death toll due to Typhoon Karding climbs to 10. The new fatalities were reported in Baliwag, Bulacan and Tanay, Rizal, both due to drowning. 8 others remain missing. As for damage to infrastructure, the National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council says it has reached over 23 million pesos. Damage to agriculture is at over 100 million pesos. But based on the Agriculture Department's tally, the typhoon left 1.3 billion pesos in damage as flooding hit rice-producing provinces. Families of the fallen rescuers in Bulacan support calls for better benefits for first responders. One of the 5 victims was Narciso Calayag Jr. His brother shared, Narciso was just a volunteer, which means he was not entitled to a salary whenever he joined rescue efforts. The wife of another victim, Gerson Resurrection, meanwhile shared, her husband was a rescuer for 15 years. Both of them believe rescuers should be properly compensated because they are putting their own lives at risk to save others.
Hindi lang po maging regular. Na sana po magkaroon po tayo ng batas para po sa mga responder, first responder, volunteers, yung risk na sinasagupa po nila. COVID na yan, yung aksidente na yan, sa pagdating sa tubig, earthquake, lahat, sakop nila.
Napakalaking bagay po para po sa mga rescuer. Kung magbibigyan po sana ng sapat na tulong ang lahat ng ating mga rescuer para po magampanan yung kanilang tungkulin dahil hindi po biro ang mga rescuer. Talaga pong sinusugal nilang kanilang buhay para po makapagligtas ng iba.
Beijing's envoy to Manila honors the sacrifice of the 5 fallen rescue workers in Bulacan. Chinese Ambassador Wang Shilian says their bravery and heroism will always be remembered. Wang also hopes for the quick recovery of storm-hit areas, adding China is always ready to help the Philippines. Parts of Pampanga province remain flooded 3 days after experiencing torrential rains brought by Typhoon Karding. In the town of Candaba alone, 14 villages are still submerged in water. Mayor Rene Malanque says damage to rice fields in the area is estimated to be worth 95 million pesos. Town officials also considering to declare a state of calamity.
Inaasahan ko hanggang mamayang apon tataas pa yung tubig, baka bukas pa po mag-umpisang bumaba ito padaloy ng dagat. May lugar pa po kung lampas tao. Pero doon po sa daan hanggang Baywang pa po. Yan po yung daan na hindi possible ngayon, manggagaling ka ng Candaba,
opo,
going to Baliwag, Bulacan, yung tinatawag namin Candaba-Baliwag Road.
Opo.
At yung isang main road, national road po namin, na Candaba going to San Miguel, Bulacan, ay hindi pa rin po possible.
Flooding also remains a problem for residents of Masantol, Pampanga. The town has been under a state of calamity since August due to floods caused by previous storms. Masantol is a catch basin for water coming from nearby provinces Bulacan and Nueva Ecija.
Kami po ay kumakatok sa inyong puso, lalo na po sa ating national government, na silipin at tignan po ang sitwasyon namin po rito. dahil ito pong aming dinadaan ang pagsubok ay hindi lamang po dala ng bagyong Karding, kung hindi ng permanenteng pagwasak sa aming bayan na pangunti-unti na nararamdaman dahil po at dulot po ng climate change.
The latest on the weather now, the low pressure area that entered the Philippines Tuesday night has developed into a tropical depression. The new storm, which was named Luis, was last spotted over 1,000 kilometers east of extreme northern Luzon. It is seen to further intensify into a tropical storm within the next 24 hours. But Weather Bureau Pagasa says it will neither make landfall nor affect the weather in the country before it exits the Philippine Area of Responsibility Thursday. Pagasa is monitoring another low-pressure area located 445 kilometers east of Guion, eastern Samar. It is expected to bring moderate to heavy rains in eastern Visayas, Caraga, and the Davao region Wednesday. After barreling through the Philippines, Typhoon Noru makes landfall in Vietnam, bringing heavy rains and damaging winds. In Da Nang, high-rise buildings shook in the strong gusts of wind that toppled trees and tore roofs off homes. Large-scale power outages have also been reported. Vietnam evacuated hundreds of thousands of people ahead of Noru's arrival. Almost half of Vietnam's airports have been shut, and schools and offices closed across several central provinces. Over in the U.S., another cyclone threatens to bring destruction. Over 2 million people in Florida are under evacuation orders as Hurricane Ian draws near. On its path toward Florida, Ian barreled through the Caribbean, hitting Cuba, and forcing mass evacuations. It also left thousands across the island nation without power. Ian is churning towards Florida as a Category 3 storm, packing winds of 195 kilometers per hour. Residents there are urged to get to higher ground, with authorities warning of potentially deadly storm surges. Severe flooding also on the forecast. The Philippine peso continues to lose ground against the U.S. dollar. The local currency hit the 59 level against the greenback intraday. That's weaker than its all-time low close of 58.99, which it touched Tuesday. An analyst says the U.S. dollar will continue to strengthen as the Federal Reserve continues to raise rates, further roiling currencies and markets around the globe.
All asset classes, currencies, equities are falling relative to the dollar. Mm-hmm. So I think eventually with remittances and a recovery in exports, we should see some relief. But the question is really when it's going to happen.
Meanwhile, at the Philippine Stock Exchange, the sell-off continues after the local bourse entered bear market territory. The PSEI falling below the 5,900 level an hour before trading ends. Despite a weak peso and a plunging stock market, Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. believes the country remains a good place to invest. Speaking at the opening of the Clark International Airport's new terminal building, Marcos asserts the Finnish infrastructure project shows why public-private partnerships should be pursued. For Marcos, it also proves the country's readiness in partnering with foreign investors to come up with beneficial projects.
It is a signal to the world that we are open for business. It is the message that we tried to carry when we were in New York. Outside of the United Nations, we met with many businessmen, mga CEO, heads of corporations. And the idea was to tell them we are willing to change in terms of documentation, procedure, even structure, even legislation to encourage you to come into the Philippines. Again, the simple message that underlay all that we did was that the Philippines is here. We are a good place to invest. We are probably the most vibrant economy that is in Southeast Asia.
International Criminal Court prosecutor Karim Khan rejects the Philippine government's arguments in seeking to stop the tribunal's probe into the drug war and Davao Death Squad killings. He's now urging the ICC's pre-trial chamber to order the resumption of the investigation. Manila had argued the ICC lacks jurisdiction to conduct the probe. It also claimed the Philippine government has investigated and prosecuted some of the alleged crimes, while the rest are still being probed. But Khan is unconvinced. He says the Philippines has failed to substantiate its claim. Its justice system is functioning well. The ICC pre-trial chamber has yet to act on Khan's request. The lawyer for families of some drug war victims welcomes the ICC prosecutor's insistence to push through with his investigation. Attorney Christina Conti expects the ICC's probe, should it push through, to look into every government official or agency behind these alleged extrajudicial killings.
We have to investigate anybody and everybody who might have had participation in the policy. But during the hearing, during the trial, you're going to determine who are most responsible. And that means you're going to sue people. In our case, for our organization, that includes President Duterte as among the most responsible for these crimes against humanity. When they stand trial as individuals, as private personalities.
A labor group slams robbery charges filed against two activists. Last December, a Quezon City court issued an arrest warrant for labor leaders Cara Tagawa and Hilary Valbuena for allegedly committing robbery. But Kilusang Mayuuno points out, the move is questionable since there was no preliminary probe conducted before the filing of the complaint. The group suspects the case is in connection with a peaceful protest in July 2020.
This happened a long time ago, and it was just now that this complaint was being opened up to, in order to file a sudden complaint against our two mass leaders. So there wasn't any benefit of a preliminary investigation, and suddenly this case has sprung up after 2 years. So obviously they are trump up charges to limit the democratic space of the protesters then and now.
The country's Commission on the Filipino Language voids its ban on allegedly subversive books. Adrian Ayalin tells us why.
The ban against five books earlier declared as subversive by some commissioners of the Komisyon sa Wikang Filipino is no longer in effect, according to the chairperson of the commission. In an earlier memorandum issued by KWF Commissioners Carmelita Abdurrahman and Benjamin Mendillo last August 9, the following titles were deemed subversive and anti-government: Teatro Politikal, Kalatas Mga Kwentong Bayan at Kwentong Buhay, Tawid Diwa sa Pananagisag ni Bienvenido Lumbera, May Hadlang Ang Umaga, and Labas Mga Palabas sa Labas ng Sentro. But according to KWF Chairperson Arthur Casanova, based on the September 20, 2022 resolution of the commission, Commissioners Alain Ros Dimson, Hope Pew, and Angela Lorenzana have withdrawn their signatures from the statement of condemnation of the supposed illegal acts of the chairman, as well as the publication and proliferation of the supposed subversive books. In that statement, the books supposedly have anti-Marcos and anti-Duterte content, and the approval of the publication and distribution of the books by the commission's chairman is considered as an attack against the government. With the withdrawal of the three commissioners of their signatures, only Abdurrahman and Mendillo remain as signatories, as they put abstained in the withdrawal resolution.
Dahil sa pagbawi ng tatlong mga commissioner na kanilang mga lagda, ang aking pong interpretasyon dyan ay void na po or moot and academic na yung sinasabi nilang hindi paglilimba, hindi pagdi-distribute, okay, at ang pagbawi sa mga aklat na nabanggit sa mga sidid aklatan.
Okay.
So wala na pong bisa yon dahil nga po sa pagbawi nagtakda ng tatlo sa limang dumagda.
Casanova also emphasized that he does not unilaterally decide on the printing and distribution of books, which undergo a thorough process. For ACT Teachers Party List Representative Franz Castro, the three commissioners who withdrew their signatures did the right thing.
Ako ay natutuwa dahil nakita pa rin ng KWF, yung majority ng member ng commission, yung sinasabi natin na above all ay yung nakalagay sa ating constitution, academic freedom, freedom of speech, at saka yung freedom of expression na ginamit ng mga author doon sa kanilang mga libro na ipinublish.
Casanova also reiterated in their resolution that it is not the job of their commission to determine if a book is subversive or not.
Ang mga author po ay siyempre po hindi nagustuhan ang naunang kapasihan o resolusyon na ang mga aklat po nila ay naglalaman ng mga subversibo at kontra-gobyerno at pinatitigil po ang paglilimbag, ang distribution at pinahuhugot ang mga aklat na naibigay na po sa iba't ibang mga sidid aklatan. Siyempre po ay hindi maganda yon sa pangalan ng mga author dahil ang mga author po ng mga nabanggit na aklat na lima ay mga award-winning writers po yan, mga ipinagalang ng mga manunulat.
Inaano natin yung budget nila, no? Binubusisi natin yung budget nila. Isa sa pinoint out natin yan na hindi ito yung mandato ng KWF. Yung i-determine kung subversibo o hindi yung libro at saka meron naman na tayong meron naman na tayong appropriate siguro na ahensya para mag-determine yan. At sabi ko nga, dapat hindi nagpapa-impluwensya ang KWF doon sa NTFL.
ABS-CBN tried to get the side of Mendilio, but he has yet to respond to our calls and texts. Adrian Ayalin, ABS-CBN News.
We're taking a quick break. Coming up, a bill mandating the registration of SIM cards in the Philippines inches closer to the president's desk. More on that when we come back. Stay back with more news. Philippine Senator Grace Poe optimistic President Marcos will sign the SIM card registration bill into law within the next 2 months. Both houses of Congress are expected to ratify the bill Wednesday. Poe, who sponsored a bill in the Senate, believes the measure will be a useful crime-fighting tool. She also assures the public there are provisions in the bill punishing telcos for possible mishandling of people's information.
The telco companies or the PTEs will be the repository of this information. And then the data officer will have to be registered with the National Privacy Commission. So not everybody will have access to that information to a level where it can compromise information that might be dangerous when given out or sold. So there are a few that will have access to it. And if there's a data breach, a company can be liable for every instance for about 4 million pesos.
The cell phone companies.
The cell phone company. Yeah. Now, if they say, should we trust the telco companies as opposed to government agencies? I think that the private companies have more to lose, in fact, if their system is compromised, because they lose the trust of their subscribers, and they will also be liable under the law for being negligent, perhaps. Mm-hmm. And this time, it's not just a blanket penalty for, let's say, one data breach. It's per data breach.
Senator Poe leaning towards the banning of Philippine offshore gaming operators in the country. For Po, the social costs of having POGOs are higher than the economic gains they bring in.
Hindi naman kasi pwede na porket na kumikita tayo sa isang bagay, ayun na lang ang susuportahan natin. Isipin din natin, ano ang kapalit nito? Diba? We want an economy where businesses find it profitable to solve social problems. That's a quote that I read. Now, conversely, we want an economy where businesses don't cause social problems. When it comes to office spaces and the decrease in demand and also in pricing, remember this POGO industry has actually created also a premature price in the market. I think prices have been going up prematurely and pricing out legitimate businesses also, as well as legitimate renters.
There have been mounting calls to ban POGOs from the country following the recent rise in kidnapping incidents involving Chinese POGO workers. Philippine lawmakers flagged the slow budget utilization for some projects of the Transportation Department. One Rider Party list of Representative Ramon Gutierrez says only 2% of tricycle drivers have so far received fuel subsidies under the agency's Pantawid Pasada program. Gutierrez now calls on the agency to speed up and ensure equitable distribution of the aid.
It's just very bewildering to see that on the component for tricycle drivers, we were only at 2%. So moving forward, we will be refining this process.
The issues of the past have been noted by DOTR. So with this circular, we will be able to hasten and cure those possible issues that might arise again. So we join you in those in the vigilance of doing such distribution, given the 2% figure for our tricycles.
An urban transport planner hits the Land Transportation Franchising and Regulatory Board's policy, which allows standing passengers inside buses and modern jeepneys. Julius Dalay says that move seems to mask a bigger problem: the lack of an efficient public transportation system in Metro Manila. He also points out passengers have long been forced to stand while commuting because the number of PUVs is just not enough.
Yung pronouncement ng NTSRB, formality na lang yun. Even nung nagbalik dun sa pandemic yung mga tao, dahil sa kulangan, nagtatayuan na sa jeep yan, sa mga bus yan, kasi nga, kulang yung supply. At yun sa ding, yung mga commuter na rin nagmamakaawa, we need to augment the supply. Yung supply na yun can be defined as mas maraming bus or yung mas mabilis na turnover ng bus.
The LTFRB recently allowed 10 to 15 standing passengers inside buses and modern jeepneys in areas under Alert Level 1. It said the move was meant to make the most out of spaces in PUVs. Switching gears now, an American TV series continues to champion inclusivity as it drops a new episode centered around Filipino characters. Yon Chavez tells us more about The Cleaning Lady.
Mistakes that she's made in the past affect her.
To play Fiona, an immigrant from the Philippines in The Cleaning Lady, Filipino-Australian actress Martha Milan says two people have helped her in a big way.
My parents are both invested in the show so much, and the way that they can actually contribute by translating, awesome. Even if it's 3 a.m. in the morning on Zoom, I'd be like, guys, wake up. Is this right? Is this the right way to say it? And then they would do a whole kind of debate of like, no, hindi yan, pero hindi. I'm just like, guys, just give me the simplification. We need to go on set now. And it was wonderful.
The series tells the story of Filipinos in Las Vegas who are dealing with the challenges of being undocumented while doing difficult jobs to raise their families. The show is the first of its kind in Hollywood primetime TV for its constant inclusion of Filipino talents in front of the cameras as well as in the writer's room, directors, producer, and even music by Ruby Ibarra.
What does it mean to you to represent and play this character and have it be on network TV?
I mean, it means everything to me, y'all. I think, like, you know, it's the first time that a Filipino is being, you know, at the forefront of the show as well and being portrayed in a way that's humanized. Yes, you know, we are cleaning ladies and the stereotype is there, but I think by watching the show, you realize that it's an authentic way to tell the story of marginalized voices in the way that we're all the same. We all go through these things. We're not just, you know, coming on and cleaning things and then we go home to bed. We're dealing with, obviously the show has extraordinary situations that we're dealing with, but I think just the day-to-day life of Fiona and Tony and the kids and the family, they're all, you know, based on family values.
Its most recent episode, titled Lolo and Lola, also features actress Princess Punsalan in her U.S. network TV debut. Punsalan and Alberto Isaac play Milan's parents who visited from the Philippines due to an urgent family situation.
There is so much humility and she's just so down to earth in every way and just giving as an actor as well that it was playing off of her was so easy and to believe that she was my mother. It was great.
Most of Fiona's scenes are with her sister-in-law Tony, played by the show star Elodie Young. The series depicts the supportive relationships of many Filipino sisters-in-law, something that hasn't been explored before in any other Hollywood stories. Yong Chavez, ABS-CBN News, here in Hollywood.
And that's the rundown. I'm Denise Densai. Thank you so much for watching. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Stay safe and stay with ANC.